So I want to get in to the idea of implementation science. Today's entire topic is how do we get things actually implemented? It's going to be the most complex and challenging thing we undertake in school systems is to get good things implemented for kids so they can benefit from it. There's the idea of like schools as warehouses. We open up schools and the goal is to occupy kids throughout the day. Or there's this idea of schools as implementation settings. Schools exist to implement. That's the whole purpose of a school. We build buildings, we ask kids from the community to come to that building, and we're supposed to do things with them that are going to produce some level of benefit. Now, some of the things we implement, we know completely don't work. Some of the things we've implemented can make kids worse, and some of the things we can implement can really transform kids' lives to make them successful. So really, it's all about implementation. My argument is that the biggest issue in our country is an access issue. Kids don't access what they need to be successful. So really, related to that, it's an implementation issue. If kids aren't accessing what they need to be successful, we're not implementing in schools what kids need in order to receive some level of benefit. That's academic, socially, emotionally, and behaviorally. Thankfully, there's an entire field that studies implementation. It's called implementation science. Our goal today is to start from like the 30,000 foot view and get by this afternoon some very tangible practices. And Dr. Keith Herman will be talking about motivational interviewing. How do you change a person's behavior when they don't want to change? That's the $1 million question. How do you get any person to change? Because that's implementation. It boils down to an individual's behavior to do something better for a kid. How do you get someone to change when they don't want to? Threaten them? Hire like muscle and intimidate them? Beg them? Debate them? We know what doesn't work. It's hard to think about what does work to change someone to implement something for the betterment of a kid. And that's what we want to explore today. So we're going to go a little bit slow to go fast to make sure we understand what this is. And so the biggest issue is we know we have all kinds of evidence-based practices available at our fingertips, but the research keeps showing that those practices don't necessarily get implemented in everyday school settings in such a way that outcomes will change. Fidelity is going to be a huge issue. Getting schools to adopt initially evidence-based programs and practices is hard. So we have all kinds of barriers to implementation that prevent kids from improving. And so we see that the same old outcomes year to year exist within school systems. And largely, it's an issue of lack of implementation of evidence-based practices. How many of you believe like physical activity is an evidence-based health practice? What's the barrier for somebody benefiting from physical activity? Not doing it. It's an evidence-based practice. It will work if you do it. Your health will improve if you commit to physical activity. How about getting good sleep? Is that an evidence-based well-being promoting practice? What's the biggest issue? Not getting enough. It's an implementation issue. Sleep will work if you do it. So it's not like, well, I don't know about the practice. No, it's going to work. That's what the evidence is, like the faith in the evidence and the rigor of the research, so it's defensible. That's where we get. So it becomes an implementation issue. If I'm depressed and I don't take my Prozac, I can't blame the Prozac, right? It's not working, but I'm not taking it. I'm not adhering. I'm not following my diet, but then I'm going to say the diet's not working. But I'm not following my diet. It's an implementation issue. And we have many implementation issues. If you look at the medical literature, the conclusion is people basically get half-assed treatment. That's what it's like. You get half of what you're supposed to get. If you look at the literature, it's about 50%. Even in the medical field, there's fidelity issues. So the same barriers that exist in medicine exist in school settings that prevent the adoption and use of effective practices. So our goal here is to get in place that which works to produce benefit to kids. And so we're going to try to understand some of the problems, okay? I want to start with anxiety disorders. How many are familiar with like the World Health Organization's data indicating internalizing disorders are the leading cause of illness among children and adolescents in the world? Okay? So that's a problem we need to address. We have more evidence-based treatments to address anxiety problems than ever before. But look at the utilization that you could see here. What are we seeing over time? And the data more recently are even seeing a decline from 2005. What are we seeing an uptick in? Meds. We're seeing a decrease in the use of psychological interventions, even though we have more evidence-based psychological interventions. It's an implementation issue. What's the problem? What explains that? Why the discrepancy? What we find is medications are readily available and they're better disseminated. It's a marketing issue. How many of you have seen, you know, you get the pharmaceutical commercials that say you're going to get diarrhea, gout, and, you know, lose a limb if you take this. How many of you see like a commercial on cognitive behavior therapy will produce significant benefits to you if you, do you see any type of marketing for psychological? What wins out? That which gets better marketed and disseminated. So think about the implications of this in the school. Dissemination is part of the implementation. To what extent are the good things for kids being disseminated and marketed within a school? It's going to impact the uptake and use of it. And often, other things are getting marketed better if they're going to win out. It's an issue of dissemination. And we find it as a significant barrier to the adoption and use of really good things. Here's one. Problem, increases in diseases. The evidence-based practice is vaccinate against diseases. What we're finding over time is fewer people vaccinating to prevent diseases, despite evidence of its effectiveness. Okay? Why? Why do we see that despite, and there's myths, like if I vaccinate, my child will get autism. So it's preventing people. There's all kinds of barriers in terms of myths about what the harm can be done in the science. Just sharing information. However, in states like Mississippi that have policy that call for vaccinations, we find that 99.4% of all children are vaccinated due to a state-level policy. So how does policy, the policy climate, and the alignment between policy and practice ensure implementation? And we have a lot of schools that there's not policy at the district or local school site level, and the policies don't call for the implementation. Imagine like adoption of a social-emotional learning curriculum, but there's no policy that says that's what we do within this district. It's going to be a harder go to get that implemented versus a system in which they have a policy that says, here's how we operate and function. We deliver social-emotional learning curriculum alongside the academic curriculum because we promote the whole child. And that then dwindles down to the local school level where there's local policy within that building that calls for the implementation. Implementation goes up due to policy. Here's an issue of selecting the wrong intervention. It's basically dead on arrival. If you select the wrong intervention at the outset, you're not going to get the, you can implement it well, and this is just an issue of selection, inappropriate selection. So using California as an example, and there's many examples of this all over the country, selecting the wrong intervention, going all in, time, money, and resources into something that doesn't work. So whole language, the state adopted it, and it's an approach to teaching reading that's not based on phonics. And here's the data. 8 years after whole language was adopted statewide in California, fourth grade reading scores plummeted to the bottom. And I don't know if you know Doug Carnine from the University of Oregon, but always has interesting commentary. Very bright person, reading expert, said this: I fear that the education leaders in California didn't see the real problem that has sent California to the absolute bottom in reading. You cannot keep using an entire state as an experiment. You wouldn't administer a drug to 3 million people without testing it first, would you? But we see this, schools are experimenting with kids because they're adopting things of no known efficacy at all and going all in. And think about the investment in terms of time, energy, and resources that can be put into selecting a practice that maybe we know at the outset doesn't work. And we see school systems do this. So how, as PENT members, are we facilitators of evidence-based practices? How do we help people become more aware of that which works, or at least scrutinize when a commercial company tries to sell something, scrutinize those practices and examine them to see if there's any evidence that it might work? And is there an alternative that does work? Staph infections in hospitals. If you're a germaphobe, do the la 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 thing, okay? Go for it, because I might gross you out here. So here's a problem in hospitals. 2 million people get staph infections. 90,000 people die per year due to staph infections in hospitals. The evidence-based practice is washing your hands, okay? Yet 33 to 50% of people do it. How many of you are like, oh, whoa? How many of you believe that washing your hands is easy and cheap? Like as an evidence-based practice. Easy and cheap. But people aren't doing it enough to prevent, create the tipping point where you can prevent staph infection. So here's the reasons why. People would complain about it's inconvenient and I don't have enough time. Does it sound familiar to education? It's inconvenient, I don't have enough time to implement an individualized plan for a kid who needs it. But I'll spend the time correcting the behavior and losing instruction, but I'll spend time, but it's not the type of time I want to use, right? And we're like, it's going to be the time saver, and we're trying to tell them that, and they still don't listen. They're not ready to implement. So you make it easier. You make it now. Have you been into hospitals where you can, like, there's basically a bath. You walk through the door, and you get, like, a bath of something. You trip over the washing things. Still wasn't enough. High alcohol content, so you create ventilation to make the alcohol content go away. Still wasn't enough. People complain. Irritation to skin, so you put aloe in that. Well, then people complained about the aloe stinks, and so they removed the aloe. They're like, oh my, how are we gonna win this battle? People aren't altering their behavior and habits to do it. Gel reduces fertility, so they shared data that it doesn't reduce your, you're not gonna go sterile as a result of cleaning your hands. So what they showed is that you can improve implementation, but not enough to reach the tipping point. Within a service setting like a hospital, there's a tipping point for implementation where the outcomes begin to really change. So what's the barriers? Are people motivated to change? How do we motivate and compel people to want to change and commit to that? And there's going to be content today. You're going to have to wait for it, and then it's going to happen after lunch. And what's the process to motivate someone to change when they don't want to? And I'm just deflecting. I'm coming up with excuses. I'm just, and you try to debate me, and I'll debate back, and I'll argue with you, or I'll just ignore you. Here's one, gum disease, big problem, okay? The evidence-based practice is regular flossing, okay? Huge problem. Huge proportion doesn't floss regular enough to prevent gum disease. What's the dental office approach? What do to try to get you to floss? They give you a baggie with floss in it and they say, hey, go do it. Yeah. Is that enough to change behavior? Dental offices haven't employed habit formation or behavior change tactics to increase flossing to the point it will prevent gum disease. Now, there's recent research that dental offices that use behavior change strategies. For example, there's an article on a community of dentistry settings where they have an app system and connect to all their patients. They provide daily prompts and reminders. They have incentives. If you log your flossing behavior, that you come in and you can get some type of extra nice toothbrush or something, one of the electronic ones. So they're employing behavior change strategies, and you can see a significant increase in people implementing the evidence-based practice. People in this room know behavior change strategies with kids. We can apply them to adults in order to change behavior for the betterment of kids. We can work through the adults to change the lives of many kids using our behavior change techniques. It's not as easy as telling someone the information and how cool a practice is, and they go, whoa, thank you, I'm gonna radically change my behavior for you. It's really about changing behavior when we talk about implementation. So here's what I want you to look at, stare at each other and talk about just for a few minutes. Why could you have two schools serving the same demographics of students in one environment, implementation is going really well, and the other environment it's not? All other things considered being equal, resources, exposure to evidence-based, one environment's going well, and the other environments, it's not going well. Then I want to take it down to a teacher level. Two teachers in the same building, one teacher getting the same resources, same exposure, one teacher implements, the other does not. What explains those differences? So if you can, just have a little bit of dialogue at your table about what are some of those system organizational barriers, and what is an individual level barrier within a school when you have variability in implementation? What's happening with individuals? Okay? So let's spend a couple of minutes and then we'll hear some ideas. So, what are organizational barriers? So the difference is we have one school that's rocking and rolling on take PBIS. They've both been introduced, they've both been, they're resourced in the same, one's doing it well, the other's just shoddy. I mean, it's like there is no, maybe they have their poster that's like this big, relegated to some tiny corner, and then they say they're a PBIS school, but you go in and you're like, oh, I hate to be the bearer of bad news, but I will be. What's going on organizationally? What'd you guys talk about? Yeah.
One thing we talked about is the relationship between the leadership and the employees. If it's a toxic work environment, it's not going to happen.
Relationship between leadership and employees. Have you ever been in an environment where that's nasty? It's the us versus them, right? And the finger pointing back and forth. Is that going to undermine implementation? Is leadership maybe the make or break at the school level to effective implementation? So, I'm going to press us as PENT members. Whether you're a leader or not, we need to align ourselves with leaders. Whether we have negative feelings towards it, we got to throw those to the side. We have to align and work through leaders. If we're going to get good things, if we all agree to leadership, you can work in your silo and put your head down and do your little FBA thingies with kids. The broader context is going to impact your ability to be successful. So it's thinking bigger. Implementation, we think bigger about the organizational variables, and Dr. Aaron Lyon's going to get into the organizational variables as well as the individual variables that are going. What's going on individually? What did you talk about? So imagine you have good leadership, and it is a healthy, but still, this person's not moving.
Motivation.
What do we usually call it, though? Starts with a B. Buy-in. Do we not? How many of you have used that? Like, they're just not bought in. What do we mean by buy-in? Properly motivated. If I'm bought in, I see a reason why. I see some value in it. Did you want to share? Yeah. something's being done to me versus I'm being incorporated and it's with me as an active participant who's invested. And we've cultivated the why behind PBIS. PBIS is the what. So I could say 3 to 5 behavioral expectations are positively stated. You develop cueing systems and you reinforce students when they exhibit. And it's like, but if I say, how many of you believe that students thrive when the adults are on the same page? How many of you believe that individuals thrive when people pay more attention to what they're doing right versus wrong? Oh yeah, well, PBIS is our method to do that, and here's how we're gonna do it. Oh, isn't that more engaging? You're tapping something internal to me, like a belief system? You're getting my input? Totally, those factors all relate to the quality of implementation in either an implementation failure or an implementation success. Yeah?
I was going to say, a couple of my schools, they're changing demographics.
Yep.
And so there are some teachers who've been there a long time, and they're very resistant to the fact that their demographics have changed.
Oh, you see this nationally, yep.
Then you see new teachers coming in, and they're on fire, and they want to buy in.
Yep. Yep.
And so it's very hard. And so this is where we have talked in our district to use the motivational interviewing piece. And that's key because you have to somehow bring people back together. But they're not all on the same page, right?
Yep.
So that's kind of a difficult thing.
Yep. There's individual belief and attitude barriers. One is Diana and I study, it's called who owns the student's behavior when they're in school? Who owns it? Because it's locus of control. Do I internally own it, or is it external to me? Meaning it's a counselor or a behavior specialist owns it, the parents own it, the student themselves is responsible for owning it. I don't own anything. And you're asking me that this changing demographics of students coming in, and I'm supposed to own this? Bullcrap, it's someone else's. And you don't see someone, they're not open and willing to change their behavior. So how do we help people own it? Because those beliefs undermine implementation. So the thing I want to get us to is a few more points before we transition. There's going to be more slides here than you need. You're just the big picture of implementation. The biggest challenge that I'll make is the billions of dollars we've invested in research to uncover effective evidence-based practices will never materialize. We'll never reap the dividends if they don't get implemented. Who cares if that journal article shows and demonstrates the evidence of something? If it doesn't make its way into everyday school settings, it doesn't matter. It doesn't matter. It was a nice, cute study that was well-funded, and there was a squadron of graduate students who went in and supported that system, but if we can't get it implemented, it's all for nothing. It's the implementation barrier. And we have different ways in which we approach this, the train and hope model, where we think the information is gonna catch fire and people are gonna be so excited, they're like, oh, thank you, I'm doing it. And then we're just like, Trial and error approach, we just throw mud at the wall, see what sticks. So we have a lot of issues. Here's the takeaway for me. You all, we have, you know how scientists like ivory tower academics like to have come up with jargon? Well, here's the implementation science jargon. You all are considered implementation intermediaries. People who have one foot into research and the other foot into practice settings. So you're this intermediary who could serve a very pivotal and vital function to facilitate the implementation of evidence-based practices. That is, if people who are in the roles, such as yourself, are knowledgeable about the factors and conditions that either serve as barriers or facilitators to high-quality implementation. The things we're going to cover today, most of them, they're no duh. But the goal is to identify a barrier and begin to strategize about how you impact that barrier. If it is leadership's the barrier, then how do we strategize? instead of admiring the problem. Remember how we don't like people to admire the problem with students? Let's not admire the implementation problem. Oh, those, I got the stupidest principal. Oh my God. Just incompetent. I don't even know how this person got there. And with that, I'm spinning off. I think probably has a mental health or an access to this. So we're just going off the deep end. We're frustrated. The bottom line is we're frustrated and agitated. But to strategically impact leadership requires a different approach. It requires that problem-solving approach that we want teachers to do with kids. Let's do it with the organizational setting. And you all have behavior change strategies at your fingertips because that's who this group is. And how can we employ those with adults so adults begin to implement really high-quality things for kids? So there's multiple ways in which you can serve as an implementation intermediary. This is the slide I would encourage you to go back to as a way of thinking about overcoming and the role you potentially can play so more students access the best practices that are currently known to us via scientific research. Okay? That's my end of like the opening of implementation science just to get us kind of framed for the day. I'm gonna now, if we can, fast forward to the, we're gonna move into a brief overview of evidence-based practices that could be undertaken to implement, ranging according to a multi-tiered system of support. Okay? What are the continuum? Do we have a question?
No.
Oh. So what are the, you're just standing
there. I'm
sorry.
I'm also
going
to talk.
Yeah. So what are the evidence-based practices that could be implemented for all kids, some kids, and a few kids? So let's dive into this. Most of the time, someone doesn't agree with MTSS. Well, I say all the time. If someone doesn't agree with MTSS, my stance is they don't know what it is. Because if you really consider what it is, there's nothing to argue against. How many of you believe that we should adopt an approach, a one-size-fits-all approach to kids? That's ideal. Let's do, all kids have the same level of needs. Let's do a one-size-fits-all approach. Okay, so MTSS is the counter to that. How many of you believe that when you open up the school door, the number one thing you can guarantee is you're going to get variability in students? Variability in what? Everything. School readiness, emotion regulation, interpersonal skills, motivation, learned behaviors that are consistent with being successful in school. Has anybody seen the kindergarten crisis in America? Like every school I go, it's like the kindergartens, and it's just developmentally you have kids who haven't learned kindergarten in the structure, but people are freaking out. But kids are going to come in with maybe a higher proportion of kindergartners are coming in without that readiness.
We call those the feral cats. They're showing up without having been previously socialized, or they have not yet seen that adults are sources of reinforcement, or that following the teacher actually has a payoff that's different than following the knucklehead kids sitting next to them. And so we're seeing also a crisis because kindergarten curriculum is now what in the olden days was first grade curriculum. So they come less prepared, and we give them an earlier exposure to consonant, vowel, consonant, handwriting, etc. Who's noticed these things? And so our kindergartens are often big sources of referrals right now in terms of things are going poorly for that particular population.
How about equity? So we have the access. The way I look at MTSS, it's an access model. It's designed to provide a continuum of support so students can access what they need. Now, it's imperfect. It's not going to ensure and make sure everybody, but we're trying to get better at making sure that kids access what they need. It's a needs-driven, equity-based framework. To me, MTSS is all about equity and access. Why? Because you're trying to develop a service delivery model in which kids get what they need. That drives decisions based on labeling what the kid has, which is a different way of doing business.
Have you ever been asked to write a behavior plan for a child who won't raise his hand and he blurts out? Anybody ever have one of those? So there you have somebody attempting to do a tier 3 intervention on a basic tier 1 issue. And that's what's happened to us across the country. We have one size fits all, a behavior plan is what all kids need. Even if their behaviors are driven by trauma and emotionality, let's give them a behavior plan. Even if the issue is poor instruction, let's give them a behavior plan. And then we get caught up into writing for the filing cabinet. How many of you have written for the filing cabinet? It's extremely frustrating and a waste of our skills.
So the last piece is, how about proactive and informative in terms of making timely and relevant decisions about kids and being super responsive to student needs at critical time points versus waiting? Because the biggest issue, like with business as usual, is the wait to fail model, the WTF model. It's like we let kids struggle, and then, hey, behavior specialist, come fix them for me. Can you? You have that BCBA thing, do something with them. Come on, magic. And you're thinking, oh, I'm actually going to change your freaking behavior. It's not about the kid, it's you. But I'm going to try to skillfully help you understand that. It's the environment. It's not the kid. And I'm going to try to make you aware of that now, and you don't get it. But it's a responsive system. MTSS is about gathering information, data, defensible data, screening, progress monitoring that can inform timely and relevant decisions.
You notice that if you don't pre-correct and you add behavior-oriented people to a campus, that you actually see an increase in escape-motivated behavior. Because the teacher says, he's a problem, let me get him out of here. And the kid learns to say, I don't really like being here. I need to go see the counselor. I need to go see the behavior specialist. I need to be anywhere other than this crappy environment that you've landed me in. And then, what is the evidence base of meeting with a child who's had a problem in the classroom? 0.00. You'll have no effect. You can't talk them out of their problem behavior. So you're caught in the system of delivering a service that's worthless. So the question is, it's not that all services is worthless, it's that the evidence-based practices that you want to be doing have been hampered by systems issue. Are we all in agreement on that?
Yes.
So tier one for all students is about both universal prevention. We get stuck in the disease-based model of thinking out of the medical model, that the goal is to prevent problems, and then mission accomplished. How many of you work in settings in which you pull from a pretty privileged community? The problems are low, so it's like celebrating success because problems are low. Look at our test scores, as if test scores indicate a human's doing really well. How many of you have read the book Price of Privilege? Anybody? I would recommend the read. It's really powerful. It's not as well as you think it is. So there's a need to promote, too, well-being. Help people enhance and optimize. Tier one isn't just about preventing problems. It's about promoting, enhancing, accelerating, optimizing performance as well. Helping people reach new heights through the supports we provide. Now we think about an ingredient in implementation science. How many, I just want you to raise your hand if you agree with this. Children thrive in positive, structured, predictable, and safe environments. How many of you agree? How many of you agree that colleagues back at your site will also agree? How do you disagree with that? That's saying, no, I think negative, unstructured, unpredictable, and unsafe environments, people thrive within that. Because we want to create like Navy SEALs, you know? That's what we want to take the military model, elite training, and we want the, you know, like, you don't know what's going to happen to you. It's a good learning environment. Now, so then the question is, you go beyond an ingredient. How do you get that? What's the methodology? What's the science say is the method? PBIS. So you link the ingredient to the practice. PBIS is currently the mechanism by which we get that in place. How many of you believe that students thrive in the context of meaningful, positive, trusting relationships with the educators?
However, we have people from the olden days, I am very familiar with the olden days, who were trained as teachers to not smile till Christmas. How many of you have heard that statement? Don't smile till Christmas. What did that mean? Have no relationships with children? Do not be a source of reinforcement for kids? Instead, push them all away? How have we noticed that plays out at our schools? Not so well. So the very structure of how we do business and what has been proven to work and proven not to work is not well disseminated into our settings. Are we all in agreement on that?
So this going beyond the ingredient, we do belief surveys. 98% of educators across the country believe that positive relationships are a foundation for learning. Okay? But how many educators do you think engage in anti-relationship strategies? Think about all the exclusionary practices. I'm thinking I'm doing something for your own good by kicking you out of here because you're going to get punishment and you're going to learn from that process. It's going to trigger an insight process where you're going to go, whoa, I've done something wrong. I better be better, let alone you don't have the skill to participate in the learning. I reject you from this environment, and it does have side effects. And then I don't try to recover from any of those negative side effects that cause you to feel less of a connection. You know Maslow's hierarchy of needs? So we used to have like social belonging above. There's plenty of evidence from like neuroscience that we need to put it on the bottom, right alongside hunger, other things. It's a basic human need to feel like you belong in a setting. Whenever there's uncertainty with your standing and your belonging in that environment, we see very negative things for kids. How many of you believe in rigorous, effective instruction to teach kids skills, not only in academics, but social, emotional, and behavioral skills? So going beyond the ingredient to what's the practice. That's why we have social, emotional learning curriculum out there, PATHS, the RULER program, Second Step, Mind Up, other types of programs, School Connect. All these SEL programs are designed to holistically teach rigorously student skills that are going to benefit them in life.
Many of us are in schools where Second Step is used. And it's done by teachers, not by counselors in pullouts. Terrific. How many of us are in schools with Mind Up, where teachers, K-8, or actually preschool through 8th grade? How many of us are in high schools where School Connect is used? It is important that we know what the SEL curriculums are and the potential impact on kids, because it will drain the swamp. When you've got too many alligators, what's the task? Drain the swamp. Children have emotional and social support needs, and we don't want to do all of them one-on-one as a tier 3 intervention. We have got to be looking, all of us, at the health of our tier 1 as PENT cadre implementation intermediaries, as Clay's calling it.
The idea to think about is if you take a kid swimming in a dirty pond, you take them out of that dirty pond, and you hose them off with good like training and a functional equivalent replacement behavior, you put the kid back in the dirty pond, is it going to impact the ability? If that environment's fractured, you're going out there and teaching, you found the skill that can be an acceptable alternative. And so we have a lot of environments, the environment needs some work. To the extent that there's fractures there, there's going to be higher levels of needs that are going to be expressed. How many of you believe in promoting student agency, where students feel empowered, motivated, they have a sense of purpose for what this is all about? Well, that's not a skill. We take a skill. This is more of a mindset. How do you trigger a mindset that there is a sense of purpose for what all this is about? I know where I'm going. How many of you work with kids who are rudderless ships, meaning they are not aiming towards anything? Do you think kids have a difficulty delaying gratification who have nothing that they're aiming for? Here's the definition of self-regulation, which is, if there is a construct, self-regulation, the ability to keep your thoughts, behaviors, and feelings in check as you pursue something that you can't immediately attain. What if you don't have something you're trying to attain? And I'm not saying like our behavioral goals, raising hand 8 out of 10 times. How is that meaningful to a kid? Or let's take an academic. You read 83 words read correct. That's really super deeply meaningful to a kid. We might need to do it to monitor progress, but how do we help kids orient to the future and be able to withstand the challenges, the adversity, their emotions as they pursue something? That's called student agency. What do we do there? If you believe in that ingredient, what are the practices? We have growth mindset lessons. We have enhanced goal setting things. One's called WHOOP, which is essentially you get kids to sing WHOOP, there it is, and they become more inspired to be rappers or something. I'm just kidding. It's a goal. WHOOP means wish, visualize outcomes, identify the obstacles, and develop plans.
You should look up WHOOP. There's some really promising practice that's going on with WHOOP. And it's all about motivating children, both intrinsically and extrinsically. We're not going to drink the Kool-Aid of one approach is better than another approach. When both approaches work together, you get enhanced well-being of children. We work on increasing their intrinsic desire to achieve, and we work on extrinsic reinforcement for taking those steps forward. And we in PENT do not have one perspective. We have a blended perspective on the needs of kids, because there's emotional needs, there's social needs, and there's behavioral needs. And all of those need to work together at school sites.
Yeah.
WOOP.
We'll give you more resources. That's just an example of an evidence-based practice.
We'll be receiving emails on WOOP. There's a lot of work now in student agency that we will be disseminating.
Yep. And a lot of it comes out of Stanford, University of Michigan, and other places. And then last, students' needs drive decisions. So here's kind of the continuum. If we think about an integrated level of universal prevention. PBIS is good, but not enough. PBIS doesn't teach social-emotional skills. Have you noticed that? What's it teach? Behavioral expectations that enable kids to be successful, but it doesn't teach them how to manage their emotions when they get upset. Does it increase their knowledge about what anxiety is and how anxiety can get the best of them and how to tame their physiology when they feel it in their body? There's nothing there. It's important, but it's not enough. SEL. Both SEL and PBIS are not really relationship-based approaches. One's about teaching expectations. The other's about teaching kids social-emotional skills. What about the relationships and the connections? There's a need for that. What we know is the majority of teachers have not received substantive training in proactive classroom management. What are the micro skills that you can implement that promote academic engagement and reduce problem behavior that interferes with learning? So we create the optimal learning environments for kids. So there's a need to integrate that. So we call it kind of an integrated level of universal prevention. What I want us to talk about here for a second is an approach. And there's different approaches, intentional approaches to building relationships with kids. What I want you to contemplate, why are positive relationships the foundation for learning and promoting motivation? Okay? Quick conversation. Why are positive relationships with the adult in a classroom foundational for learning and increasing students' motivation to do the work in the class? How would it work if I went to someone random outside on the sidewalk and I went and tried to praise them? I did behavior-specific praise. It was contingent and specific. How many of you think that would serve as a reinforcer for that person? How many of you think that would probably be freaking creepy? Like, oh, dude, what are you going to do to me? Like, whoa. Do you think to use your attention as a reinforcer, you have to have a relationship intact? So your attention is reinforcing. So the most readily available reinforcer at any human's disposal is their attention. Guess what makes your attention a reinforcer? Relationship. We see a lot of adults trying to praise kids and there's no relationship. And they're like, will you just get away from me? Like, actually, it's a punisher. Authenticity. It's not like awkward, creepy praise. And we see some, hey, look at you. You're a sitter. You're sitting. Like, oh, my God. You're thinking, I want to uppercut you so bad. Relationship. How about correcting another human's behavior? What do you think needs to be there? So the words that come out of your mouth are likely to produce a change in behavior. Trust, a desire to want to listen. Like there's that, okay, I don't feel, whatever I'm doing right now, I don't want to do, but I'm going to do it for you. How do you have to leverage relationship for everything. Here's the thing. We say things like trust. How do you build trust, though? That's the place where an intentional school system to create a good universal, they talk about the methodology. That's like a heart surgeon saying, exactly, I'm going to open you up. Here's what I'm going to do to make this procedure. How about in education, we don't get to that level where we can say, we believe, and here's precisely how we go about doing it. This is the methodology, and the outcome is trust. The outcome is sense of connection. The outcome is you feel like you're understood. So what's the methodology? And there are practices out there that have made it more concrete on the methodology that people as a school building can implement so no kid falls through the relational cracks. One of the trickiest issues, and this is just a busy slide that organizes how to effectively respond to problem behavior. And it's a sequential process. But one of the ways we harm relationships is when there's problem behavior, because the way in which the adults can respond. When we train people in this, the first goal when you respond to problem behavior is always don't do anything. What do you mean? The first step's don't do anything? Yeah, the first step's not do anything and regulate yourself first.
I call that the technique. The child has just told you to F off. The most important thing you can do at that moment is turn your face away from the child so that you won't copy their amygdala, and you say, and turn away. Get yourself organized, and then turn back so that they can copy your affect and you don't copy theirs. How many of you have seen a child escalated by an adult response to their problem? So the strategy can be quite effective.
One of the core relational techniques, whether you're consulting with a teacher, you're delivering a training, or you're working with an individual student who's a live wire, is to express empathy. Empathy statements are one of your weapons of mass influence. What do adults say if I say, this crap's unfair? What's the adult response? Life's unfair, chump. I'm the one who's gonna finally teach you this lesson, wimp. And I'm gonna harden you up. That's what you need from me right this moment. It's an anti-empathy statement. What's an empathy statement? I understand. I've been there. When things are unfair, man, I'm not cool with what's happening. So I know where you're at right now, and that doesn't make me feel good. Here's the deal, though. You're doing this, and it's disrupting. I can come back and talk to you about what you find unfair. Maybe we can work out a solution that works for you and me. Here's what I need you to do instead. Here's why. Think about when we correct behavior, helping people develop methods whereby the goal is to correct behavior and preserve relationship at the same time. Now that might be a good, but people don't, when they look into their bag of tricks, there's nothing there. So let's move on. Next, social emotional learning curriculum. Think about this. Again, I'm going to get back to self-regulation. Social emotional skills help kids regulate what? Themselves in interpersonal situations. How many of you know kids who need help learning how to regulate and they're not a human with a disability? How many of you view learning how to interact successfully in interpersonal situations is a life skill and a vocational skill? How about managing emotions? Is that a life skill? Is that a vocational skill? Will that help someone move and shake in life? So SEL is designed to teach those skills that otherwise won't be taught. And we make no assumption. We give it to all kids. So that's it, adopting a skill. I mean, a curriculum. There's 45,000 schools nationwide implementing SEL. Often, it's implemented very sporadically and not as a universal prevention and promotion support. What does universal mean? Everyone's doing it. And so what we find is mainly most schools do the drive-by counselor approach, where the counselor goes to random classrooms periodically and delivers lessons. That's 2 weeks to produce any change. And it's almost, if you looked at the effects, you might as well not maybe spend the time. The best is to spend the time figuring out how you're going to get it implemented. Spend that same time but with that person, not doing the drive-by, but figuring out how we get this implemented universally so we can reach that tipping point to produce outcomes.
There's a belief barrier. I teach academics. I shouldn't have to teach anything other than academics. How many of you have heard that or know that that exists? So there's an underlying non-supportive belief that's causing the lack of adoption of effective instruction across every classroom for both positive reinforcement of rule following behavior, appropriate corrections, and then the teaching of social emotional skills. Our jobs would be very much different if all children had had that floor of opportunity to learn emotion management. Are we all in agreement on that?
Yes.
Educators should all over themselves. And this is what I mean. The kid should. I shouldn't have to. The parent should. Should. And when you hear that, it's a cue that there might be a belief barrier, and you have to take an alternative approach to working with the person. And trying to debate and just show them evidence isn't likely to be the easiest approach. You have to take a different stance with that individual. And you'll see these, particularly when it comes to, you mean I'm doing this in the classroom as a teacher? This will become potentially unionized? And we've seen it all in terms of adoption.
On academic performance when a classroom teacher uses SEL curriculum.
So the large-scale meta-analysis, the best kind of average effect, you get 11 percentile increase in academics without changing anything related to academics. The idea is social emotional skills are either enablers or disablers to learning. To the extent students acquire them and are supported to utilize them over time, it enables kids to profit from their learning experiences. To the extent I have social emotional problems and can't regulate myself in interpersonal situations or manage my emotions, it disables my ability to reap benefits from my learning. And so that's the effects just in the area of academics alone. School-wide PBIS. How many of you have worked in a PBIS system, but you've seen, like, people are emphasizing character traits instead of behavioral expectations? So we always ask, like, what does passion look like? What would you teach a kid overtly what passion would look like? You know, you see that, or enthusiasm. Am I supposed to really be enthusiastic? Or imagine in high school what passion in the hallway would look like. You'd need a hose or a stick to get kids off of each other. So PBS is, it's a really a pitch thing, it's a marketing. How do you get people invested in this model? Because that's one of the biggest barriers. It's not super complex in terms of the idea behind it. It is somewhat complex to change people's behavior to do it. But you have to pitch it right. The way in which we often think about pitching is PBS is an organizational model that works for any human. Here's how. How many of you have received an unclear job kind of specification? You got this thing and you're like, what am I going to end up doing with this? Do people perform better when they're very unclear about what to do to be successful, or when they're crystal clear on how to be successful and what the expectations are for the role? Okay, so could all, a Fortune 50 company, could employees maybe benefit from knowing what they're going into and what the objectives are? Now, does it, the health of the organization, does it work better on, you know, reacting and punishing people when they don't live up to the expectations, or proactively teaching, supporting people, paying more attention to what they're doing right, and privately correcting things when they go wrong? And what you find is if you pitch it right, people, and then just like PBS is how we're going to do this organizational model. If you pitch it right, if you pitch it wrong, well, we need to come in, we need an extrinsic reinforcement system, because all humans, reinforcement means increasing the future likelihood of behavior. So we need that. And we come in, and all that's triggering is, well, first of all, I think extrinsic reinforcement harms intrinsic motivation, and that's my belief. Think about how many individuals possess that belief. Are they going to resist or be on board? So how do we get this thing adopted and implemented, because it helps produce a more safe, productive, and orderly environment? Proactive classroom management, we've organized these. There's currently 18 that we've uncovered, independent, standalone classroom management practices that promote academic engagement and reduce problem behavior. Some of these don't come from the traditional behavior analytic classroom management literature. Some do. The goal is, how do we get teachers to adopt and implement this So behavior is being managed on the front end versus being reacted to on the back end. And we've done the data for every 1 minute that's invested in a proactive classroom management procedure, someone reaps 5 to 8 minutes on the back end. For every 1 minute you invest on the front end to prevent problems, you reap 5 to 8 minutes on the back end.
Instructional time is gained or lost 1 minute at a time. Say it with me. Instructional time is gained or lost 1 minute at a time. If it takes you 5 minutes to turn in homework and it takes me 2, what's the difference? 3 minutes. Multiply 3 across a year, and you're looking at more instructional time when you have mastered proactive classroom management strategies. And this is really consistent with all of the teacher models we have, like Danielson and some of the other methods of looking at what does effective quality instruction look like. One of our greatest problems is that we're not teaching well. Have we noticed this? Effective instruction actually works to prevent problem behaviors. Why? Because if they're on task, they're not what? I think we're on to something. When does problem behavior happen? At off task. So if I can get them on task and engage, voila, I don't have the rates of problem behavior that a teacher has who does not have instructional practices that demonstrate mastery of the proactive classroom management.
The goal with this is there's a tendency for most people to say, oh yeah, I do that. You know, oh yeah, I do that. Oh, you positively greet at the door to welcome kids into the room and engage in pre-correction and do private words of encouragement for students who struggled the previous day to get them on track. Oh yeah, I think I do that. And you go look and they're like, we're gonna have a good day, right? Well, I welcomed her into the room. What are you talking about? So there is a big fidelity issue and a need to calibrate people to implement these strategies, because the tendency when we go in, oh yeah, we do a lot of these things already. And the reality is not with necessarily the fidelity with which where you can start to drive the outcomes.
In God we trust, in all others show me the data. Say it with me. In God we trust, in all others show me the data. Show me the data that you have 5 to 1 positive acknowledgement for every correction. Show me the data that you provide reinforcement publicly but correction privately. I'm gonna go to my grave fighting against card pulling. You know, we start the day at green and then I yell at you a little bit till you're down at yellow and then you're in the bucket, you're at the red zone. How many of you are familiar with this insane thing? And that is completely contraindicated for relationship building and effective classroom management. That's not a methodology we can support in schools. It's counterproductive, and it increases a child's hatred of school, and the very kids that need to have correction are publicly exposed as not belonging. And what do we know about belonging? As mentioned, belonging is a fundamental human need. There's even some literature that shows that bullying is being learned by kids from teachers. Yes. So what is that statement really mean? We have to change how we do business in schools.
So the last piece for Tier 1 is the student agency interventions. Growth mindset, mental contrast, that's the WHOOP. That's a rotten name for WHOOP, mental contrast with implementation intentions. It's an evidence-based practice that's been over 20 years in the making. We have another, this is the really exciting stuff that gets me going, is it's called Future Possible Selves and the outcome data. You get kids as young as 5 years old can envision a future self that you can then anchor and get them motivated to engage in the steps that will help them get there. But it's an exploratory process where you get kids to envision a desired self and an undesired self. You backward map it and you make them crystal clear on the steps that need to be taken to get there. and the strategies or skills or people who they may need help from to stay on that desired pathway. How do you know if you're going on the undesired pathway? It gets kids to think beyond their immediate needs, like I want to just get a laugh out of you, or I want to just say no because this is boring to me. It transforms their interpretation. Really exciting. It's called the school to jobs, but there's specific interventions. It's one thing saying this is important. It's another actually doing things and implementing practices with kids to make it happen. Before break, I want to touch on Tier 2. Tier 2 is probably the weakest support system in most schools. There's shooting in the dark. There's making stuff up. There's force feeding. Because you have one intervention, everybody gets it. How many of you work in school where you have lunch groups, and that's the Tier 2 intervention? And it's like, lunch group. And what do you do there? It's like a potpourri of things. Well, we do a little bit of leadership things. We're trying to work on self-confidence, and we're doing some, it's just made up stuff. So we've been able to spend some time and energy trying to develop with school systems a process for Tier 2. Tier 2 is not an event. It's not an intervention. It's a process, a sequence of practices or procedures that you combine together. And we call it the AIM squared procedures. The first step, whenever you identify a kid who needs a Tier 2 intervention, the first is to match the kid to the most appropriate intervention. What we find in behavior is it's equivalent in academics taking a kid with a reading deficit and giving them a math intervention. It's a mismatched intervention. It's not going to work because it's not what the kid needs. So if you don't select the right intervention at the outset, the whole process is for none. Then what we find is many people, when they start something, they never gather baseline data. So essentially, we've developed what we call TurboTax for Tier 2. If you follow the process and the system, you will act like an expert. Like as if you went and got a couple PhDs in this. If you follow the process, so you just follow, match the intervention, establish baseline, implement the intervention, make sure this kid benefits from the active ingredients, monitor the kid's response, and then meet to make a decision. So really, we embed it within a problem-solving process. And here's what I want to kind of show you how it works. Given the problem-solving, anytime you identify a kid with a problem, as we all know through function-based training, who cares what the behavior looks like? Why is the kid doing it? So the first step, now here's how many of you think it's unreal. Take 20% of the school you work in. Let's take a 500-student school. What's 20% of 500? 100. What's the average length of time it takes to conduct a good FBA? Now do the math. So are we going to do FBAs on all kids who need a Tier 2? It's not feasible and practical. It would be nice if we were that resource. So you have to, in our view, you have to have a different paradigm. And it's consistent with FBA. And what we do is we sort kids whether they're an acquisition deficit or a performance deficit. An acquisition deficit means the kid needs an instructional intervention because they lack a skill. It's like a kid who can't read. The problem behavior as a result is they can't read, they're being asked to read. It doesn't matter what reinforcement you put in front of them, they can't read. That's not going to suck reading out of them. You need to teach them to read. Same thing as we know the environment's putting demands on kids and they don't have the skills to meet those. So the inherent nature of the intervention is an instructional one. But then not all kids who have an acquisition deficit need the same instruction. So again, the system sorts kids into do they need an emotion regulation skill or a behavioral regulation skill, and it further sorts.
In other words, is the child's problem a can't-do problem or a won't-do problem? And oftentimes we put all kids into a social skills training group, and they're perfectly capable of doing the social skill. There's a reason why they aren't doing it. It's not a can't-do problem. Turns out it really was a won't-do problem. So it's important you discriminate between
between those two?
Oppositional skill versus what?
Performance is the kid has knowledge and the skill, they possess it, but they're not utilizing. The environment, it's an environmentally embedded intervention. It's improperly motivated. There's not enough supports to encourage the kid to use the skills. So what we do is help people using an assessment system make linkages to the evidence-based interventions on the bottom. So essentially, it sorts a kid to the intervention that's likely to be the most effective. And we've done randomized control trials on this to show. Now, that's a tier two process that considers a menu of options instead of a single. The last piece I want to point out here, and where it's break time, is tier three. Having a decision tree there, making sure kids get the supports they need. Which kids, the treatment of choice is likely a function-based behavior intervention kit plan. Which kids, really at the core, the kid can't manage emotions, thoughts and emotions, and the kid needs cognitive behavior therapy or some other therapeutic service that targets those root causes. So we have a way of trying to sort kids into the appropriate treatment, if you will, at that highest tier of supports. So those are the continuum of evidence-based practices that we can think about need to get integrated within a school building. Now our job as implementation intermediaries is to incrementally improve the degree to which really good supports and services are available for kids to access. And you all can play a significant role. We're going to take a 15-minute break, and we'll come back.